Time to wake up your mind. Time to be informed, engaged, and empowered. It's time for the Eric Dawson Radio Show.
Just wanted to call and say what's up.
Oh, it's you.
Hey, bro.
Yo, what's up, man?
Well, listening to you.
Thank you very much.
We've got news from Essex County, New Jersey, and beyond.
In obscene terms, he said,
accountability starts here.
Now give me a beat.
I'm concerned because we haven't elected people who, to me, have the acumen to begin to try to figure it out.
It's the Eric Dawson Radio Show on RTH 2000.
Hey, good morning. This is the Eric Dawson Radio Show, 95.1 FM, RTH 2000. I'm going to put the calling numbers in the feed in a minute. Actually, I could probably put them in from my phone. But the calling number is 973-672-1271 or 973-677-3753. And if you care to listen through your phone, you can dial 641-793-8228. And I'm here with, when I introduce you, right, should I say like the descendant of the relative, you know, tell me how you want me to do this.
Introduce me as Maurice Clark, you know.
Just Maurice Clark.
Yeah.
But you don't want them to have the understanding of the lineage.
I think people that know me, they do understand.
But there's some people.
And then that people that don't, we could touch down.
Listen, because we have people who tune in every day, different people.
Yeah, definitely.
You know what I'm saying? So for new people who have never seen you, never heard of you, we don't want to make the assumption that they don't understand the greatness that runs through your bloodstream.
So look, we could do that, but at the same time, I think at this point in time, just coming into my own now, you know, so I don't look at it as
separating. Wait a minute now. Come on. See now, this is part of the challenge, man. You know, I mean, I respect the fact that you're coming into your own.
Yeah.
You know. And I, at 55 years old, I would say that I've come into my own. Mm-hmm. But having said that, I understand the shoulders that I stand on.
Oh, yeah, definitely.
My grandparents, my father, my mm-hmm. mother, yeah. my grandmother,
definitely,
Crawford.
Definitely.
And so, you know, there is never a shortage of time where I say that I am, Willie Mae Crawford's grandson.
So how about we do... This is the great nephew of Joe Clark, Maurice Clark, and then we go ahead. If you're not familiar with who Joe Clark is, Joe Clark is a revolutionary in his own right. He saved the school. He saved Eastside High. And if you're not familiar, check out that movie Lean on Me. He was also the director of the youth house where he went on ahead and used those tactics at Eastside High and brought it to the youth house and. He changed a lot of lives, and that's the path that I'm on in my own right. Not at that level that he did it, but on a different level. So, you know, I pay homage to my great uncle. You know, growing up, I really didn't get a chance to spend much time with him, but as I got older, you know, we built a good relationship. So I owe him a good share of love and respect. Also to my great uncles and my grandmother and my great aunts who were part of the Black Panther Party, much respect. And also to the fact that I'm marching with Dr. King and going through a lot of oppression and adversity. And if it weren't for them putting it down, I probably wouldn't even be here today.
Well, that's what I'm saying. Put some respect on it, man. Come on, stop. So listen, man, as we were getting ready to come on air, I said to you that this whole... Will we call it a movement at this point? I don't know.
I think we should start calling it a movement because, you know, a lot of people are not really doing what it is that we're doing. So I say we have a movement.
So I say we have the start of a movement.
Mm-hmm.
And we have right now a little over, maybe 48 people now. We got to just check and make sure who have committed, right? But these mm-hmm. are all verbal commitments. Yeah. And I've been in this game long enough, Maurice, to understand, man, that, you know, when that day comes, right, and all those verbal commitments that were put out there, and there's three people out there with you, and, you know, you making phone calls, yo, I was going to come, and what happened, what happened, that and the other, and so I'm saying they're verbal commitments,
yeah,
right? But we'll see what it turns into when we actually launch the date to do it,
okay,
right? But the thing is that right now, for those people who don't know, we've decided to hit the streets, because 85% of people stayed home in the last election.
Yeah.
And we look at what's going on in Irvington, Orange, East Orange, not much different.
Oh, no, not at all.
Right? And so we're beginning in Newark, but we plan to take it to Orange, take it to East Orange, take it to Irvington, and do what the Democratic Party has failed to do, the Republican Party has not been doing, and that is to really engage the people,
exactly,
to have a conversation with the people, to wake the people up.
Exactly.
You know, we were told in this past election in Newark that there was a concerted effort by the party to keep people asleep and only target a certain number of people to win an election and not to win the people.
Yeah.
You see, not to wake the people up. And there is a revolution going on, and everybody needs to be
a part of it.
A part of it. When we talk about the crime in the street, when we talk about the poverty, when we talk about the low wages, when we talk about everybody's a part of what's going on, when we talk about the foreclosure rate that's sweeping across this state, everybody's being affected by it. But the political machine, Maurice, made a concerted effort to say, we're going to keep you, we're going to lull you all to sleep. We're going to wake up just enough people who we give trinkets to get involved so that we can continue to do what we want to do.
Definitely.
Right? And then somehow, whether you're talking about from Tritton, you know, all the way up here, they're claiming victories.
I'm not going to claim that as a victory. I mean, I can understand why it's a victory for them, but it's not a victory for us.
It's not a victory for the people. You can't say that it's a victory for the people.
No, not at all.
Right? When you got homelessness off the chain, when you got all of these issues that are going on, there is no victory to be had for the people.
Not at all.
They're individuals who are benefiting.
Exactly. That's why I said it's a victory for them, but it's not one for us.
Right. So we're talking
about this whole revolution. I'm just going to touch down on this. Revolution is not just...
I thought we were done with touchdowns.
Well, I'm going to speak on
it. Oh, okay.
That's
I thought.
not the way they meant it. But when we speak about revolution, it's not just a matter of talking. You can't stand on the sidelines and criticize and not do nothing about it. So this revolution is about getting out and putting the work in, out here grinding. That's what the revolution is. It's not about the colors. It's not about the dashikis or none of that. It's not about... everything that you know is mostly about what you do. You know, at this point in time, we're tired of hearing about talking. We want to see action. And to all my young people out here, you know, we going to go ahead and give y'all the opportunity and have a seat at the table with us and join us. So this is what this whole thing is about, us walking and knocking on doors and engaging. This is where the revolution begins. It's not a matter of just being in a group and talking, and then when we leave, nothing comes out of it. That's not what a revolution is. So I want y'all to think about that.
So when we begin to do that, so Terrence Bankston, again, I believe, haven't been able to talk to him, but we did talk about him coming back on the show.
Yeah.
And the idea was that he was going to be on Tuesdays, right?
Okay.
And that we were going to begin to fill these seats up, because that's what I want you guys to do.
Yeah.
Right? Mm-hmm. I'm giving you the platform.
Definitely.
But I need you guys to fill these seats up. There should never be a day that Terrence Bankston is on, that Maurice Clark is on, Nitty number two, who I've had in here before, who wants to come on again.
Okay.
We've had some other young people in here. But we should be filling these mics up every time you're on, and
we should
have an overflow in that room out there of people who are climbing over each other to get to the mic, right? Because if I don't see that, because to me, that is the performance indicator, Maurice, that says, you know what, you all are getting engaged. But when I continue to present a platform to people who have said continuously, we haven't been given a place at the table.
Well, I want people to understand that right here, coming in here, is having a seat at the table. A lot of people tune in. This platform is for the voice of the voiceless, but here's the opportunity to use that voice. Once people hear that voice and hear what we have to say, then the changes will go ahead and start being made. It may not happen overnight, but it's a process. Right. So I say y'all come in, and let's all come in and come together and have an honest conversation, no matter what the issue is. If y'all want to talk about jobs, economics, criminal justice reform, it don't matter. I think we all need to have a conversation on every issue.
So now, I have to say this before we move on. You know, I posted something on my page this morning, and then I took it down, and then after I took it down, I regretted taking it down. We have to be willing to have conversations. So, we were talking about a company. Forget mm-hmm. about the individual.
Yeah.
We were talking about a company mm-hmm. that was established, and the company is Elite Strategies. And the company, and months ago, we were talking about this company that was established for the purpose of, in part, or maybe in whole,
yeah.
of laundering money or being able to move money. Because if you understand how political campaigns work, once you make a contribution to a political campaign, that money has to now be used for that campaign.
Yeah, definitely.
So I can't just write you a check if you say, yo, I want to go buy a car. Mm-hmm. Or if you have rent that you need to pay, I can't write you a check from the campaign fund. So what happens sometimes is you have companies that are established, and those companies that are established are through companies,
yeah.
right, where I bill you mm-hmm. for a service that I may or may not have done. You, as the campaign treasurer or whomever, write me a check. Now the money is free and clear for me to be able to go and give a check to this person to pay their rent or to do whatever it is they're going to do.
Mm-hmm.
And that's called laundering
yeah.
when you do it like that. So let's be clear. Called laundering. Right, because you, mm-hmm. the intent was to take the money, clean it up, so now it could be used for a purpose that it wasn't originally intended.
Yeah. Yeah. Mm-hmm.
So, Elite Strategies, that was formed, right,
yeah.
Had a sole client, which was Mayor Baraka.
Mm-hmm.
And lots of money flowed through that company yeah. from that campaign. Some of the money unaccounted for. And as a result of it being unaccounted for, both in terms of us being able to see it, as well as the federal government having a report of it,
mm-hmm.
you had two individuals, top-level people within that organization or company, who were sentenced to federal crime.
Yep.
That's true. That's fact.
Yeah, definitely. That is fact.
One of them, Linda Juma,
mm-hmm.
Who... In addition to this, and the reason I'm laying this out like this is because when I put it up there, I got a phone call from one person and I got a text message from another person saying, Eric, take that down. Eric, what does this have to do with anything? Eric, why do you have a gripe against us? I said, wait a minute. We have to understand what news is, and we mm-hmm. have to be able to talk about it, and we have to remove the emotionalism from it when we do it.
Oh, yeah, definitely.
So, and I said to them, and this was after I'd taken it down and I regret it, I'm going to put it back up just so you guys know. But when I put the issue up about Kanye West, nobody called me and said, hey, Eric, why are you talking about Kanye? Right? It was new.
Oh, yeah, definitely.
I posted it. We talked about it. So the emotionalism isn't on this side. It's on the side of people who, for whatever reason, don't want accountability to be on the table.
Definitely.
So now let's continue. So now this company that was formed in part or in whole mm-hmm. to launder money from a political campaign.
Yeah.
Two individuals, top level within the company, were found guilty of federal crime and were sentenced. Right? One of them, the mayor was, I believe, the best man at that guy's wedding. The other one, I would say, given photos and public appearances and such, that they have a rather close relationship. So now you've got the mayor with a close relationship with two people who started an organization with the sole purpose or a purpose in part to launder money,
yeah.
who are now convicted felons, right?
Oh, yeah.
And now the one person where I would say that a lot of people, if they didn't have political connections, may have been serving jail time.
Oh, yeah, of course.
Was given an ankle bracelet and was given house restriction. And according to the documents that I posted, which are all legal documents, because now there's a warrant and she's being called back into court to answer for things. Mm. Because she's violated not on one, not on two, but according to the documents, on multiple occasions.
Yeah.
The terms of the house arrest. Right? Including continuing to push the company that was originally founded in part or in whole to be a laundering firm for money coming from a political campaign. Now, and you have the mayor, who has no issue being in company, public company, with a person who is in violation of... I want you to understand this now.
Nah, I definitely get it.
So 8 days after an election, in violation of, and we shouldn't talk about it.
No, we need to talk about
it. We got to talk about it.
People got to be aware of what's going on. We can't.
So the mayor has no issue with being in public company with a person, with a convicted felon who is in violation of their sentence. There is no public condemnation of it. I get phone calls. Eric, take it down. This is part and parcel of what is wrong in our community, that there is no accountability.
Of course.
Now let me go further. So the technology allows the court to know when you are outside of the parameters that bracelet tells you you're supposed to be within.
Yeah.
So, according to the documents, not Eric, ain't making this up.
Mm-hmm.
According to the documents, they gave her the opportunity to go work, which everybody should be given the opportunity to.
Oh, yeah,
they could go work. But she has reported to the courts 10 hours worth of work. Meanwhile, the technology of the bracelet that determines where you were says that you were gone 64 hours. So there are 54 unaccounted hours.
Mm-hmm.
Well, I mean, I want you to... And then people say, don't talk about it.
Gotta talk about it. Can't be censored. You know what I'm saying? Like, that ain't how this thing work. You know, you can't call other people bluff and not expect your own to be called. You know, that's just a reality. Sometimes
you
deal with the consequences of your actions.
Right. And so so where are the consequences? And that becomes a question, right? So if now you've committed a crime, you've been found guilty, you've been sentenced, and now you don't feel like you have to serve the time that you were sentenced, and the mayor himself says, well, I don't think you should either. Come hang out with me. And then you've got people in that circle say, don't talk about it.
Yeah.
Don't talk about it. Now, I was done. My assumption was she did what she did.
Mm-hmm.
The courts found her guilty. They imposed the sentence. Serve your time, and we're finished. Now there's now I start to look and say, is there an abuse? You see, and so if the court doesn't step in and say, you know what, you have violated the terms.
Mm-hmm.
Violated them. She was remanded during her sentencing for previous, absolutely, during her sentencing.
Mm-hmm.
And so the question now is, well, is there special treatment? See, these are conversations, because all I want to know is this. Brother, if you had the same issue, are you going to be treated the same way?
Not at all.
If somebody else has the same issue, are they going to be treated? And if they're not, then we need to deal with that.
Mm-hmm.
We talk about social justice within our community, right, that we want fairness. Well, where's the cry for fairness now?
Exactly.
Where is the cry for fairness now? Let's take this call. Hello, call. Thanks for being patient.
Good good morning. It's Ali's mom. And how you doing?
I figured it was you. What's going on, brother?
Okay, good morning. Who are you saying is laundering? Because they weren't convicted for laundering. They were convicted for tax evasion.
No. So I understand.
Wait, Kabari was convicted for using money from the daycare.
Stealing money from the daycare. Okay. Not using. Yeah. Let's use the terms. Stealing money from the daycare. Ruining families and stealing money from children who needed it. Defaming his family's name. Let's talk about it. You're going to call into this show to defend this nonsense, then we're going to talk about it.
Be careful of slandering somebody. You're not talking about the mayor was laundering money.
No, I didn't say the mayor. No, I said a firm. I said a firm that
okay, right. So what I'm saying to you, the federal government investigated this situation, and believe me, they have more resources than you ever have.
Right.
But Eric Dawson is going to sit down and say that this company.
Well, you know what it is. So what I'm going to say to you is this, right? And I'm going to take this from that movie: it's not what you know; it's what you can prove.
No,
and so, because they couldn't prove it, but it doesn't mean that I don't know it. So let's be clear about this. I'm not going to let you talk over me. I'm going to finish what I had to say, and then I'll let you say what you want to say. It's not what you know, it's what you can prove. And the federal government can prove it. So if we go and we talk about the young man who was slain by Zimmerman, we all know what happened, but they couldn't prove it. So it doesn't mean it didn't happen. So let's be clear about that.
Faces in the federal system. There's no smiling faces. Whatever Linda do, it has nothing to do with the progress of Nook.
Did she violate the terms of her sentencing? I'm asking. No, it's not her business. It is not her business. It is in the public domain. And now we have a mayor who has absolutely no issue hanging around a person who is in violation, repeated violation.
Why wasn't a mayor charged?
I'm sorry? No. You're missing the conversation. The conversation is around whether or not she is in violation, whether the mayor knew she was in violation, and whether he is complicit in helping her violate. That becomes part of the question too. Is he driving around with her? Does he know that she ain't supposed to be where she is? Is he driving her around? Is he using taxpayer dollars to get her where she's got to go? Is she driving in the Tahoe? Because if she is, then that's my business.
Personal business.
See, when you have people who call in to defend the nonsense, you got to treat them.
Got to treat them accordingly.
Yeah. It's nonsense.
Mm-hmm. Definitely.
It's nonsense.
It definitely is. Like I said, you know, at the end of the day.
What would be the difference, Maurice? Wait a minute. What would be the difference, right? Because for all intents and purposes, the bracelet says she's supposed to be imprisoned within her home.
Mm-hmm.
What would be the difference if I had gone to Rahway State Prison, picked you up, and drove you out while you were serving a sentence? You hanging with me. What's the difference? So to try to put lipstick on a pig and make it something different, no. No. She's a convicted felon. And that we have our elected leadership, we have people in our business community. Let's talk about it. She's at these events that she's not supposed to be at, according to the documents, promoting a business. The very business.
That's under investigation.
Thank you. Then you get a phone call in from somebody who's a representative of this administration.
Well, you know how it is. You know, you represent that person, and you're going to go ahead and say whatever they need you to say. You know what I'm saying? That'll make it right. You know what I'm saying? But as long as we doing what's right and we hold the people accountable and putting that fire underneath them, then that's all we can do. You know, sometimes we're going to have to deal with the emotions and the ignorance and everything, but you know, that's just the society we live in. And as long as we keep doing what we're doing and holding people accountable and revealing the truth and waking people up, then I say that's a win for us. if everybody else wanted to be stuck in the same cycle, then that's on them. You know, we can't save everybody.
I'm trying to find it because it's important, man. And I apologize. I apologize for taking it down. So, let's see. The offender has violated the special supervision conditions, which states so special. So she was given special supervision. Has violated the special supervision and conditions, which states you must submit to the location monitoring program as noted below for a period of 8 months. You must submit to home detention and comply with the program requirements. And so my question is, did the mayor not know this? He don't know that she gotta submit to this? All of the people, our assemblywoman Cleo Tucker, who's at these events too, she don't know? Then share the show, guys, so that they understand the terms of conditions. So that they should have said to Linda, go home. Go home.
Yeah.
See, so some of it is about Linda, but some of it is about our leadership or lack thereof.
Lack of.
So now you see her there, you're having cocktails with her, you're taking pictures with her, and you know she should be home.
Mm-hmm. Definitely.
Send her home. There is no leadership.
Nope,
and a call in here on this show and try to cover it up and try to explain it away. Are you serious? So I'm going to read it to you so you know when you see her, send her home. You must submit to home detention and comply with the program requirements as directed by the U.S. Probation Office. You will be restricted to your residence at all times except for employment, education, religious service, medical substance abuse, and mental health treatment. Court-ordered obligations and any other such time specifically authorized by the U.S. Probation Office. The location monitoring technology is at the discretion of the U.S. Probation Office. You must pay the cost for the monitor. To date, Juma has made several leave requests for employment totaling 64 hours. However, she has submitted pay stubs that only reflect a 5-hour work week totaling 10 hours biweekly. Our office would not have authorized these for employment, which is not reflected in pay stub. There are 54 hours claimed for work that are unaccounted and unverified. The offender misrepresented what her leave requests were for and how many hours she worked. I'm not going to read no more.
I don't think you need to.
I'm not going to read no more. And so to get a phone call that says, come like that, take that down.
Yeah.
Don't talk about it. Mm-hmm. No, I'm asking all of the leadership to step up and lead. To lead.
Definitely.
That's what it's about. So that's why it's about her, right? Okay. It's about the firm that's still being investigated. Mm-hmm. Yeah, it's not what you know, it's what you can prove. But I know when you have a single firm that is established, right? It has one client. With tons of money, overbilling happening. And then you have both executive officers within that company accused of tax evasion. What it says to me, and I may be wrong, but I'm gonna tell you what it says to me. It says to me, hey Maurice, you asked me to bill $50,000 for this thing that's really worth $2,000. So I'm gonna bill $50,000 for it. Then Marie says to me, maybe, right? Maybe. Marie says, all right, Eric, well, you know, I'm going to give you $2,000. I'm going to give you another $2,000 for your trouble. But then you give me the other $46,000 back. Mm. Well, then if I gave you the other $46,000 back, then you know what I'm saying? Well, hell, why do I have to put on my taxes the whole $50,000? I'm going to only put the $4,000 you gave me. I'm telling you, man, you know, we got to have the conversations, and then we have to get to a place where we're doing right by the community, because that's really the goal, right? That's the objective, to do right by the community. Then we're going to have to ferret this stuff out. It's dirty. It's murky. It's ugly.
Of course.
It's uncomfortable.
I think the only people that speak out is the people who are not aware. And then the ones that are aware just don't care, you know. But like I said, there is a percentage out there that wants to know this information. And I think we're doing the right thing.
And here's the other piece. The water. Got a phone call yesterday about the water. Eric, you're misrepresenting the water. You're misrepresenting the water. The idea isn't that from the reservoir that we have lead in the reservoir. Did I ever say that?
No.
I have never said that. I said the delivery systems. In fact, I posted all of the documents that the organization sent saying that, and I'll repeat it again, Mayor Baraka, based on what you sent us when you did your tests, the lead levels in some cases were 3 times that of what is acceptable. In some cases, 9 times that. We want to know what you're doing to notify the public and what you're doing to abate the issue. We want to know timelines. We also want to know about your delivery system. And then from that, there was no reply. Repeatedly, no reply. And then when there were Oprah requests made, they were denied. That's fact.
Obviously, it's something to hide. You know,
and so I'm saying, look, if you have an agency, Maurice, that is simply saying, hey, look, we got this, and some of these numbers are higher than what we saw in Flint, Michigan. Yeah. We want to make sure that the people, the residents in the city of Newark, some 300,000 plus people, are aware. Are you notifying them? And please tell us how. Are you looking to abate it? And please tell us how. If there's a timeline that you have in mind, please let us know. Mm-hmm. And they say, no, we're not telling you nothing. Mm-hmm. We're not giving you no information. Then the organization said, well, we're going to go Oprah it. And they say, well, we're still not going to give it to you. Yeah. I look and say, well, again, not what you know, but what you can prove, right? Mm-hmm. But what I know is that smells like a cover-up.
Oh, yeah, definitely. Mm-hmm.
Right?
Of course.
And so now, The for sure, it is the delivery system. But what the lawyers and such that I was on the phone with a couple of days ago, day before yesterday, were saying is that there are minerals in our water. This is what I said yesterday. There are minerals in the water, at the reservoir, in all water, not just Newark's water. There are minerals. And those minerals coming in contact with these copper pipes or lead pipes create additional issues. That's what I said. Because that's what they said to me. And right now, as we speak, I'm working on an information sheet that is going to be shared out in the community. And this information sheet, the information that I have, has been gathered from these environmental people.
It's factual.
Facts. Now, what I say is this. The mayor, in an attempt during the campaign, sent out a robocall saying that the water was safe. why didn't the mayor, when he in September got the information from these folks, and they said, well, what are you doing to communicate to people? Why didn't he send out a robocall then? That technology exists, right? Because he did it. Mm-hmm. Send out a robocall. Because one of the things that I found out, and I didn't know, but being on the phone with them and reading the literature, they say, look, if you got lead in the water, right, and even if it's coming through your delivery system, your pipes into your house, boiling the water is not a good thing to do. And most people say, I'm going to go boil my water. Yeah. So why wouldn't the mayor use the robocall system to send out an alert to people, don't boil your water? That's not what he did. He said, your water is safe.
Mm-hmm. Well, I think a lot of times people just speak out of a blind eye. You know, you can't give information if you don't have information yourself. So I don't necessarily think that really anything was done, truthfully. I just think they did what they normally do, you know, sweep it under the rug and try to convince the people, okay, you know, we're safe, and if there's any issue, maybe, you know, you let us know, and maybe we'll get to it when it's convenient for us. That's what I believe.
So I'm going to try to find, and I didn't have it queued up, but I'm going to try to locate the documents and read some of the documents from the water stuff, if I can locate them. And because these are all very, very serious issues, right? Oh, yeah. And you know what? So there's a pattern. There's a pattern of this administration just stonewalling on information. Right, on the delivery of information. We're not going to give you that. Whether we're talking about the Willie Parker stuff, right, not going to give you that. I read that yesterday, some of it, right? Repeated requests from the legal firm saying, you know, discovery. Yeah. And then recognizing that they have to turn it over. They know they do. Mm-hmm. And then agreeing to a date to turn it over and then kicking the can down the road. Mm-hmm. And then with the water thing, kicking the can. And then addressing it dishonestly during the election. Mm-hmm. Talking about paint chips. Who the hell was talking about paint chips? Where did that come from?
Nothing surprises me anymore, to be honest with you. But we called this before they even got in office, though. So, you know, I just hope now people understand. You know exactly what it is that's going on, and that y'all gonna have to deal with this for another 4 years.
Mm. Well, you know, we'll be here to do what we can do to assist in resolving this. Mm-hmm. And I'm trying to find this because this information was actually sent to me by the environmental group in an email. And that's and I don't remember the name of the lady who sent it. That's what's taking me so long to locate it in my email. But it's just devastating, man. It's devastating news. What are you guys doing? What's the youth, young people, millennials? What are you guys doing in preparation for the November elections? The
midterm elections.
Right.
I can't speak for what everyone is doing. I know as far as me and a few people I know, we are going to be involved with some of the different congressional races that's going on. We got some people out in Ohio that's going to be involved with the election process out there. So I think... the more we get involved in, we hold people accountable to what they're saying on their campaigns. Should they win, we're going to go ahead and keep that dialogue open. So right now, just creating that dialogue, talking one-on-one with different candidates, or sometimes, you know, talking in a group, because we want to know what makes you stand out from the person that's already in office or the person that you're running against. So just having that conversation. And then on top of that, getting people registered to vote is another important thing. I had people hitting me up like, how do I register to vote? You know, what's the deadline to register to vote? So I had to explain to them, you got 21 days until the election. You know, that's the deadline, 21 days before the election comes. You could go ahead and register to vote. So I sent them on different websites, and now I got about 25 people that's registered to vote. So now they'll be ready to go.
So do you guys have in line folks within your ranks who will be challenging district leader seats?
That's what we're working on. That's the next step we're working on. You know, first we had to see exactly what did they know about the current election cycle, and mm-hmm. we had to make sure they were registered to vote. I had to, you know, make sure we started off in that process first before we can encourage them to do anything. So now that's the next step. Go ahead and encourage them to go ahead and be challenges and go ahead and work the polls. So that's the next step. But I had to get them registered to vote first before I did anything.
Okay. And so now in this boot camp that I told you that I wanted to start, and again, I don't want to be in charge of anything, mm-hmm. right? I want to put the ideas out there, and then I want to be a resource mm-hmm. if the idea is a good idea.
Yeah.
So what I want to do is float ideas out. If you or others believe that those are good ideas,
yes.
then I want to become a resource to help those ideas come to fruition.
Mm-hmm.
I don't want to be in charge.
Yeah.
One of the things, and I think Bron Rice said it, one of the biggest issues with having a movement, right, is when the movement is reliant on a single person.
Yeah.
See, the success and the sustainability of a movement, of any movement, is when you broaden the base
yeah.
and you have many, many people who are involved and are at leadership positions.
Mm-hmm.
Anytime, guys, you see a movement where you got one person who's being praised,
yeah.
right? Mm-hmm. One person who's being praised.
Exactly.
That movement is in jeopardy from the beginning
yeah.
because that person, we're all fallible,
mm-hmm.
right? And we are all subject to being compromised.
Oh, yeah, definitely.
And if we rely on a single person to carry the torch the entire way,
mm-hmm.
we're going to fail.
Yeah. Well, that's the thing about the open program. You know, my boy Jack, you know, he started the movement, but he realized that there were many different ways that people can contribute.
Mm-hmm.
So now that we opened it up to recreation and agriculture and politics, you know, we have different people in those positions. I handle the political aspect. We got people that handle the economic aspect, the financial aspect, the agricultural, the recreation. We have those movements to the point now we've been officially recognized by the Black Panther Party. So Aaron Dixon gave us approval. Elaine Brown gave us approval. We have a lot of elders giving us approval, even the political soldiers who still haven't seen the light of day and still locked up behind bars have recognized what we're doing. And we partnered up with people in Baltimore, Kansas City, Atlanta, California, New Era, Detroit. Shout out to them for embracing our movement. So that's what it takes. It takes people coming together and having that common interest. You know what I'm saying? As long as we have the love, the compassion, the consistency, that's what keeps it going. And knowing that every day we're making progress, that's what keeps it going. So anyone that's starting the movement of their own, that's what you have to do. You have to branch out and find other people who not necessarily think like you, but share the same beliefs as you do. So that's what the open program is about. You know, Jack doesn't just go ahead and do his own thing. Even when he does go out and do stuff, he includes everybody. And anybody out there with a movement, you need to look at that and look at what we're doing. And you could piggyback off of it if you want advice on how we came together for this whole thing. Reach out. You could hit us up on Facebook. You could hit us up on Instagram. We got videos on YouTube. We got the open YouTube page. And we about to have, we got the open blog that's about to start where people could go ahead and call in. They could go ahead and write stuff on the blog and everything. So that's what we about, you know. That's the definition of a movement. And right here, what we're doing on the radio right here is a movement. So it's all about how you go ahead and utilize your plans. You got the best plan in the world, but if you're not willing to put it to work, or you don't have anyone with you, it's doomed.
So I, you know, my technology is growing, man. You see, I got my laptop over here, my iPad over here. Daryl Taylor. I don't know if you saw the episode when I had Daryl Taylor on. Called him an original Black Panther. Not you know, from Black Panther Party, but just a Black Panther in terms of that movie. You know, when the movie came out and everybody was talking about Wakanda and going in and all that kind. Well, that brother, for decades, been working as a band leader over at Weequake High School. And, you know, because of some politics and some other kinds of stuff, man, you know, they did not really recognize him and give him the opportunity to continue to do the great work that he's doing. Oh, he's here. So I'm going to ask you if you would, just go check the back door and we'll bring him in. That's great. So, you know, Daryl Taylor's coming and is going to talk about, you see him? And is going to talk about, you know, his new venture. Unfortunately, he said, I'm out front now, making my way to the back. No?
I'll see if you're up front.
All right. Now, you may be going out front while he's going around the back. You may want to go around the back. But don't lock yourself out. Make sure you leave the thing right. But he's going to talk about his new venture. Unfortunately, you know, and it was a compelling story. And so when he comes in, I'm going to ask him to repeat that story because he talked about saving at least 1,000 kids' lives, impacting them. And out of impacting 1,000 kids, he said, I think maybe one or two got into trouble. And so self-taught in all of the instruments, self-taught in twirling and all the other things that are required, that are requisites to managing and instructing a band. He did all of that for the love of the community and for the love of those kids. Then, if I don't have it wrong, what happened was the band director left. And so Daryl, who had been doing this for free for these decades, I left that part out, said, oh my gosh, there's an opportunity now for me to continue to do what I love, what I'm passionate about, what I'm apparently successful at. The kids love me, the community loves me and embraces me. I can actually earn a living doing this. And then he got shut down. For political reasons. But I'll let him talk about it. There he is. Would you get him set up on a, give him your headsets and then set your, try those on down, see if those work. We'll put you in this front seat. Or you wanna move down? Can you hear me? Those work for you?
Yeah.
All right, cool. All right, so we're going to put you right there in that seat.
Gotcha.
Right next to mic number 5, which is already hot. There we go. So I started to tell your story, brother, but I'm going to let you, because what's important, because it was profound and moving to me, who you are, what you do, how you started doing it. And what I started telling the folks is, you know, that you're self-taught in all the things that you did. And it was out of the passion and compassion for these babies in our community.
Right.
So go ahead, introduce yourself and tell your story, bro.
Well, my name is Daryl Taylor. I was the assistant band director for Weequill High School for this year made 31 years. And through that time, you know, my goal since I became an adult was to help youth, you know, achieve success through music, and not only that, you know, find a way off the streets, mentoring, you know, because I know how important it is to have, a man in your life, because I grew up without a father, so I never knew him, and I knew the importance of, you know, what it means, because I know the pain that I felt not having a man to turn to. My mother was the best. I mean, she couldn't have done no more than what she did. I can't say nothing negative about my childhood, you know, but there's always that void that you need, you know, from a male role model, especially as a young man growing up. So I had took on that challenge, you know. I had a man who was a band director while I was in high school and several years after, Otis Brown Jr. He took me under his wing and he taught me about not only band business, about life, about being a man, about being a good father. So pretty much everything that I am today, as far as being a man, I pretty much owe to him. Mm-hmm. You know, so big shout out to him. And every time I talk to him, I get a chance, I tell him, and I remind him, and I thank him every time.
So in your 31 years of volunteering, and you know, you guys made some tremendous strides. How many kids during that 31 years would you imagine you touched?
Thousands.
Right.
Yeah, we've.
And if you had to estimate out of thousands of kids, how many lives do you think you saved?
I can say honestly, about 95%. I mean, nothing's ever perfect, but they are most of the kids who came through the program while under Mr. Brown, and as when he moved on and took a higher position and under Mr. Page, who was the current band director, we've saved a lot of lives. I mean, we've put numerous kids in college. Not only just college, or if, you know, they didn't go to college, they got out and became productive people in society. And a lot of them, you know, they come back and give back and help me to this day, you know, to continue the process. You know, what they got from me, what they got from Mr. Page, what they got from Mr. Brown, they all come back and they helping as well to give back what they got from us.
And so now in that time, so when you came here, when I met you,
right,
there was a crisis. The director was leaving, and you saw an opportunity to possibly move into a position where you were going to now be paid for the thing that you were doing out of just the love of your heart.
Right.
Right? And you met a lot of obstacles.
Right.
And what were those obstacles?
Well, the main obstacle was that they said in order for me to take over as head band director, that I would need approximately 60 college credits. And so I said to them, I said, 60 credits? I said, I got 31 years of experience. I said, I taught myself how to read, write, compose, transpose music. I could play every instrument from a flute to a tuba, every type of drum there is. I play it all. You know, I choreographer, I make up the dance routines. I teach the flag twirlers. Make up the drills on the field. I said, even people who go to college for music, they don't teach that for band director. You understand? When you go to college for music, you know, you learn foundation, whatever. But the band director is something that's totally different. That's not something that they teach you inside of a college classroom. Mm-hmm. You know, that's something you learn through experience.
Yeah.
So I went to several board meetings and talked to several people, and then I got this and this and this and that. Somebody said, you can go this route, you can go this route. But the end result was, to this day, I haven't heard anything. So what happened was, the 60 kids that were in the band a week, it just went away. You know, I had kids crying, calling me, when are we gonna start back up, what are we gonna do? I said, well, you know what? I sat down with my brother, who's my horn instructor, and I sat down with my son, who's my drum instructor, and a couple of parents. I said, listen, I've been pondering this for a while, and I said, well, we're gonna start our own band. So we talked to some people, and we got the process started. We started a nonprofit. Today, we finalized our 501c.
Congratulations.
Thank you. Yeah, we got our tax ID number. We have our EIN number. We opened our bank account today. We get our post office box today. We registered our name and our logo.
Congratulations.
So right now we are known as the Essex and Union County Marching Thunder, EAU. So what that does is that we're taking kids from 5 and up from Essex and Union County to participate in a dual county marching band.
Mm. So now how does that differ? Because when I think of, I was never much of a band guy, but when I think about high school bands, for me, well, you know what? That's not true. Because I have my daughter who, and you, so because you're a band guy, you know, Governor Livingston.
Mm-hmm.
Right. Very good band.
Right.
right? My daughter was a flag twirler in the Governor Livingston Band, and they won all kinds of awards, and they traveled to Scotland and some other places. And so outside of just football, which is where we normally see the band, because we, you know, we go to the games and the band performs the halftime stuff. There's a whole lot more that that band does outside of the football season.
Marching band isn't just about football games. And that's what people, a lot of people don't understand. There's a lot of parades. I mean, there are parades throughout the state, out of the state. They are all around. And that's the glory of it. I mean, football games are the small part of it. I mean, because you're in the stands, you play music, you do a halftime show, you know, and pretty much come back in the stands. But when you're doing parades, man, it's beautiful. You got people up and down the street. You see all nationalities, all races. Everybody's cheering, you know, and it's just phenomenal. I mean, I get a bigger rush from parades than I do football games. And, you know, and that's the idea of what we want to do with this band. Is the reason why we opened it up to both counties, is because one thing I noticed that when we did do football games, when we played schools like Livingston and Verona, there was kind of like the standoffish where you had the kids up there were kind of afraid of our kids. You know what I'm saying? Because of the stereotype that they get from Newark or whatever. Then you had some of our kids who were intimidated by the other kids simply because, you know, they may come from an upper class. So what I said was, I wanted to open it up countywide and try to get kids from all nationalities to come together so both sides can see you don't have to be scared of us and we don't have to be intimidated by them. So that's one of the main reasons that we also want to teach our kids how to deal with all nationalities, you know.
Well, the true story. It's a very, very true story. Now, you know, I take every opportunity I can, too, to say that, you know, I rep Central High Blue Devils, right? Okay, that's all right, brother. That's all right. You know, listen, I lived
I in Columbia, you know, CHS all day.
Okay. You know, now, you know, I lived on Leslie Street, and Coach Adams wanted me to play, but my dad wanted me to go to Science High School. That's how I wound up playing for Central. But there was a game at Unterman, and it's Unterman. People got to stop saying Utterman.
Utterman.
There's an N in there, right? If you say Utterman Field, say, what are you talking about? It's Unterman Field. So there was a game being played there. Central was playing, and I don't remember who Central was playing. They weren't playing, or maybe it was just a band competition that was at Unterman Field. And Governor Livingston was coming down to perform. Right now, my daughter was a senior then. Governor Livingston High School sent a letter home to all of the parents. True story. I don't have the letter. I wish I did. Warning the parents who would be attending the game, saying that the kids would be safe because they would be on a bus that would drive right into, you know, the back of. But saying to the parents who would be parking on the street and who were, they literally listed a set of safety instructions because these parents were coming from Berkeley Heights down to Newark. Make sure you lock your doors, make sure you don't leave any valuables on your seat, make sure you put things in the trunk. And then they went as far as to talk about gangs and the colors that the parents should avoid wearing, that their kids should avoid wearing. And I'm sitting here reading this, man, because, you know, I was living in Berkeley Heights, but hell, my parents live seven blocks from Unterman Field. You know what I'm saying? So I'm like, yo, I'm going to park my car right on Chancellor Avenue and I'm going to walk right on into the... But to your point, there's, it's a whole different world, even though that school and those kids aren't even 10 miles away. Right? Their perception. And so can you imagine as they were riding down, as the parents were riding down, what the hell did they think they were going to encounter? And then they're sitting in the stands with these kids. And to your point, our kids, because of their lack of exposure, you know, they don't know what to expect from these kids that are coming down. And that's the thing that I love about band.
It definitely can bring together everybody. You know, it's music. You know, music is a universal language that everybody speaks. And you'd be surprised when our drum line, the first performance of the drum line that we did as, you know, Essex Union County, EU as I call it, we did downtown. It was a Stop the Violence or Gun thing. It was about a month or so ago down in Military Park.
Mm-hmm.
And we, you know, we was down there, we played, and we did a little march around Washington Street, came back down Broad Street. And when people were asking who were we were telling them, and I, you know, told them who we were, and I said, you know, we're going to start, you know, getting a program together. When I tell you, people would give me their phone numbers, and I'm not talking about black people, Asian, Jews, Hispanics.
Yeah.
Okay. Of course, you know, us as well. But the response that we got
was universal.
And they were like, I would love for my child to learn the style of drumming and the show band performance style. So I got business cards. I said, okay. I said, I gotta really get this going. Because there were a lot of people who said that they would support it.
Okay.
You know, so what I'm in the process now is of doing is setting up a meeting with several mayors, starting with our mayor in Newark, as well as Irvington.
Mm-hmm.
I kind of want to settle Essex County first,
mm-hmm.
and then we'll move into Union County to get the mayors on board, because you're going to need a lot of support. Because I'm expecting by the end of this year, we'll be well over 200.
Okay.
Because as it's sitting now, we're sitting at about 90 now.
Okay.
So what kind of support would you be looking for?
Well, for one, donations of equipment.
Yeah.
Trying to get everybody to come together, because eventually we're going to need a building,
mm-hmm.
you know, a location. Right now, Douglas Freeman, who's the Wheatway Park Sports Authority,
mm-hmm.
he said right now at this point we can use his facility
okay.
to practice here. I'm trying to set up a meeting with whoever the coordinator is at Warnaco Park,
mm-hmm.
so we can use their facility. Because what I want to do is, being in this Essex and Union County, I want to split the difference. I don't want to just be primarily based here. We got the kids that's going to travel from Union County to Essex County, they're going to have a hump at one week.
Yeah.
And then next week, the kids from Essex County got to have that same hump to Union County.
Mm-hmm.
So, you know, we want to kind of go back and forth. I just don't want it to be primarily based, you know, out of Newark or Essex County.
Mm-hmm.
You know, I just kind of keep it, you know, right down the middle.
Mm-hmm.
Let's take this call.
I like that.
Hello, caller.
Good morning, young soldier. Good morning. I call you a hero because
you
know,
thank you.
It's funny, Eric. Some of the things y'all discussing on there. That's how I know y'all are so true, and y'all not lying about things. So that's why I'm a big fan of the show. But one thing, they are scared. I worked in Milburn Summit. They are scared of little kids. But the second thing that y'all were talking about was how music brings all races together. My professor friend at Cali in Montclair State, he has a jazz band, and they meet, and I sat in at lunchtime on some of their practices, and trust me, all races of kids are a part of that. So what you're saying about the band and what music does, what art does, man, is so impressive, man. I've seen it firsthand account. And I just want to say to the brother, I'm proud of you, man, for stepping out.
Thank you.
And establishing yourself, man, because people like you is much needed, man. That's what the great opportunity about this radio program, giving you a voice, man. And again, I'm proud of you and what you're doing, man. Nothing but the best for you.
Thank you. I appreciate it.
Definitely.
Thanks for the call. So let me ask you this question. You know, I was, when I first met you, and you know, dude, you know, I've gone through so many emotional roller coaster rides since doing this show, because you get to talk to people and they pour themselves out over these microphones, right? And I left going, man, you know, how's that working out? You know, how's he doing? What about those kids? So there is a new band director at Wheatway.
From what I currently understand, there, Mr. Page, who was there, who was a good friend of mine,
mm-hmm.
I don't think he's back. I don't.
Okay.
At this present time, there is not a marching band.
So there is not a marching band at Wheatway. So the idea of the salvation that was provided for those kids doesn't exist right now. So we'll pray and hope that we that can get resolved. And people need to understand that. And so for all of the folks who would not provide the opportunity for you, they need to understand. And folks, you all need to understand what Daryl is saying too, that the thousands upon thousands of kids that he touched and said that, you know, 95% of them may have been in some trouble or some sort of trouble had it not been for the ban. So now when we talk about, see, this is the thing, when we talk about crime, how do you talk about crime and a reduction of crime without, you know, looking at stuff like that and saying, well, wait a minute, that's a big part of the, of reducing crime,
yeah,
right? Mm-hmm. And then now we have a void, and we may very well, if we don't get a ban, have a spike
right
in crime. Don't you understand this, y'all? So it's not just drums and trumpets and horns and all those things. We're talking about how to keep the community intact.
Mm-hmm. Yeah. And it's a shame. And, you know, this program that we're going to have regardless.
You well, know, your program, but right, I'm, yeah, and then right. we're gonna, I'm going to finish talking about yours, but I'm saying in particular in that neighborhood now.
And that...
It's destabilized as a result.
Yeah, it's rough because Weekway's band has been a staple in the South Ward since I can remember being a kid living on Pomona Avenue. And I used to watch Weekway High School homecoming. They used to come down Aldean Street. Mm-hmm. I used to watch them as a little kid because my neighbor across the street was drum major. I should remember watching them as a kid.
Mm-hmm.
And it's always been that band in that neighborhood. I mean, we even from when I came out, we marched through the streets, people come sit out on the porch. Mm-hmm. You know, you get some neighbors that complain every year. You get the same neighbors that complain, yeah. Oh, y'all making all that noise. But, you know, when they kids walking home and they see me, they say, you know, as much as I complain, I'd rather see those kids banging on drums than breaking in my house.
Mm-hmm.
You know, so when you hear things like that, you know you're doing a good job.
Yeah.
But right now, your neighborhood's quiet. The school's quiet. I got people calling me, asking me what's going on. I said, listen, I try. You know, I try to present myself. And it wasn't even about the money.
Mm-hmm.
You know, you understand? It yeah. never was. Hell, I did it 31 years without a dollar.
Mm-hmm.
If it was some way that I'd do it now,
yeah.
I would. You understand? Mm-hmm. Just for the simple fact of that I know that the impact that it has to saving children, like keeping them off the street.
Yeah.
There has been numerous shootings on Chancellor Avenue
mm-hmm.
during the time that we would be in band practice. You know what I'm saying? Thing, you know, this is recent. I'm not talking about over the past few weeks.
Yeah.
You know, Maple and Chancellor, Chancellor Wainwright. These are where my kids go to eat.
Yeah.
You understand? So when I heard that there was a couple of shootings, I jumped in my truck and I tell the story. I was in my boxes. I ran right out. I didn't even realize it. Because I'm a retired law enforcement. I grabbed my piece. I run out the house in my drawers. You know, because I heard there was a shooting on Chancellor Wainwright. Not realizing that, none of my kids are up there because there's no band anymore. But still, you go check.
Yeah. Mm-hmm.
You know, before not to be there now, it hurts. I mean, it hurts.
I think that the importance of having a band has been lost and has gone unrecognized and not appreciated. People say that music doesn't open up doors, and it actually does. A lot of kids... It brings out the confidence, and it helps them believe in themselves. You know, just like anything with martial arts and boxing, it brings discipline, it brings self-confidence. It allows you to go ahead and see that there's other things out there. You don't have to throw a ball or dribble a ball or anything. You know, it shows you that you're gifted. You know what I'm saying? And a lot of kids go on to be in the symphony. You know, we should go ahead and teach kids about the symphony.
Yeah.
You know, and bring that importance and open up.
But the truth of the matter is this. And I'm going to say it. You know, and folks say, Eric, you know, you run around, chick a little, the sky is falling. But I want you all to be very, very careful.
Mm-hmm.
Because based on the information you're telling me, which is why I asked, how many thousands of kids are you involved or were involved?
Mm-hmm.
How many thousands of kids now won't be involved? And when we look at the fact that we talk all the time about, well, we got to find something for our kids to do. We don't have any after-school programs. We don't have any of this. And the idle mind is the playground of the devil. So we put all that information out there. and then you let this program collapse. Mm-hmm. I'm saying to you guys once again, I'm telling you, there is a destabilization right now in the Weak Wake section of Newark as a result of it. And those kids who would normally be in band practice, who would be focusing on this, and the ones who would be admiring those who are in band practice and looking forward to something, they have nothing right now. Wouldn't you understand? There, to me, is a sense of urgency.
Mm-hmm.
The sense of urgency.
Yeah.
And I'm saying that you all need to get your asses down to Board of Education meetings. Mm-hmm. You need to get your asses over to Weak Wake High School, and you need to figure out how they can get this thing reinstated. I'm telling you. We can't just sit and listen to this, guys. This is what I talk about, Dawson. I say, folks tune into the show and they listen and, you know, great show, Eric, another great show. I don't do these to have great shows. I do them to inform, engage, and empower. And so here's the empowerment piece, right? So we informed them. We're asking them to get engaged. And then we say, empower yourselves to change the quality of the life over there in the South Ward. Because I'm telling you, it is destabilized right now.
I've been there my whole life. You know, I was law enforcement there. I was educated there. I still live in the South Florida. And you just see it change. And every day I sit on my porch when school gets out, and I look at the kids. They have no purpose. It's like they want to be, but our kids are strong.
Oh, yeah.
But the thing is, the first thing that gets hold of them is what they're going to be very good at, whether it's musicians or murderer. You understand? It's going to be either one, because we are so talented, and we grasp on to things, and whatever we decide we want to do, we do it well, whether it's good or bad.
Yeah.
So I've always said, listen, let's get them. That's why I start getting kids at 5, 6, 7 years old, start teaching them at that age. You know, not only do I teach you music, we are family.
Yeah.
You understand? So when the program dissolved, it was like a family that broke apart, you know? And we're coming back together now because of the program I'm instituting, but it was a rough 2 months. I mean, I questioned myself a lot. I went through every emotion there was. I think I even made up some. Mm. I was mad, I was angry, I was scared, I was, I was everything. I mean, but you know what, I got over it. And I said, I can't afford to be these things. I got to get my head up, lift my head up, because they are people, young adults, who are relying on me to get my act together in order to move forward and to continue to give them purpose and something for them to do. So I strapped up my boots, got with my brother, my son, a few other people, and we got this thing together.
So now, in terms of the needs, we were talking about that. So you're working to pull the mayors together for resources.
Right.
Do you have a website?
Well, we're in the process of creating the website.
Okay.
Right now. I mean, by June 2nd is our launch date.
Right.
That we plan on actually having our recruiting in Weekway Park, actually.
Mm-hmm.
You know, that's going to be where the band, the students that we have now,
mm-hmm.
primarily the kids in the band in Weekway and a couple of other people, we're going to be performing in Weekway Park.
Okay.
You know, it's going to be part of our registration and, you know, get a little bit more information. We're going to have our shirts with our logos and everything, you know, on it.
Mm-hmm.
So June 2nd is pretty much the launch date.
Okay.
The main thing now is getting the instruments and the equipment. So I had a friend of mine tell me, he said, well, Dan, I said, listen, you got almost 1,000 Facebook friends. You know people who know people. He said, why don't you do this? Because they did this. I have a cousin of mine who's in L.A., and they did the same thing in L.A. You challenge 200 people to donate $100. That's 20 grand. That'd be the starting money for us to get the instruments that we need for the program to go forward. Because the instruments are not cheap.
Now, I'm gonna get mad again. You know, I told Charles he got to get rid of these glass desks and put wooden ones in, because I'm going to put my fist through here one day. When you were on the last show, you talked about how you need to raise money for uniforms.
Right.
And you went to our community, you went to our leadership, you went to everybody, and you couldn't raise it. And then you wound up on a
Matter of Vieira show.
On a television show. Mm-hmm. And after you were on the show, you got calls with people complaining that you aired our dirty laundry about the fact that our community wasn't being supported.
Yes.
Right. So I want you to understand this. Now, remember, I posted something the other day where I said our people are conditioned, Daryl, to settle for less, but they want more always as long as somebody else is willing to work for it.
Right.
What you think about? I mean, dude, it's the truest statement. Like literally, and I thought about that about 1 or 2 o'clock in the morning. I'm like, man, there it is. That is the statement. And so I agree with you. It's real simple. Yeah. All the people who are here right now, which is why I asked you, they call you up right now, right? And they could say, hey, look, you know, we talk about our communities being dirty. We talk about the high crime. We talk about nothing for kids to do. We talk about all those things.
Yeah.
Okay, here we go. Here's an opportunity. Inform, engage, empower.
Yeah, we definitely going to get it off the ground. I mean,
I'm going to do whatever I can do to help, man, because, my hope is, I want to talk to you off air. You know, we're looking here to, you know, just create positive partnerships. You know, folks in the community who are doing really good work, leveraging this platform to get the work out, you know, the word out about the work you're doing, right. And then to do whatever we can to help raise funds. Even if, you know, we do a, what do you call them, like a telethon, right? And we raise, you know, money. Be nice for the Eric Dawson Radio Show to be able to say, hey, look, through our telethon, we were able to raise $500 or $1,000 to be able to give to you and those kids to keep doing what you're doing. So we'll be working on that end. And on June 2nd, we're going to be there. They're too broadcasting, you know, the launch of this amazing thing.
That's good. That's like I tell everybody, you got the tax ID number, you can write it off.
So right now, for people who wanted to, if they wanted to donate anything, how could they do it before you get your website and everything up? Is there a number they can contact or?
Yeah, they can contact me, you know, my personal cell phone for now. We're going to have our own, you know, cell phone line set up. Like I said, today I'm going to open up the bank account and the P.O. box. So, you know, hopefully Eric got next week, you know, I come back. That way I have your shirt because we're getting shirts made.
Okay.
I have your name up there, you know, Eric Dawson, Eric Essex Jr. Because, you know, and at that point, we'll have everything established.
So then what we'll do next week, we're going to promote it for next week. You tell me what day.
Okay.
And we're going to do like a little mini telethon.
Yeah.
And we're going to see if, because you'll have your tax ID, you'll have all your stuff set up. Mm-hmm. And so people will be able to call and pledge money right here on the phone.
Right. Mm-hmm. And if you want to bring a couple of the kids in.
Bring them.
You
know, they can talk.
Done. Yes. Please do.
Done.
Yeah. And it's, you know, at first when it happened, I was really, really mad. But you know what, though? I must say, my youngest son, his mother, she told me years ago, she said, Daryl, she said, you're wasting your time. I said, what are you talking about, Sonia? She said, you're bigger than Weekway High School right now, and you don't realize it. She said, you have outgrown it. She said, you need to do what you do on a grander scale because there's too many restrictions. There's too much red tape you have to go through. It seems like they're fighting you to do the right thing. She said, it is your time to move on and get your own. She said, now if you want to come back and do it, fine. She said, but you're to the point to where you need to do what you do on a grander scale. And I didn't listen. And she told me, she said, if you don't listen, God gonna make me say, you're gonna hurt. And it wasn't a lie, it hurt. You know, literally I felt stabbed in the back and I said, man, you do this to me 2 years after I got uniforms and instruments? For years when we didn't have anything and I went to you, nothing. You know, and then last year, we went to Florida after 13 years and won first place over 8 bands throughout the country in the national band competition with taped up instruments, dented instruments, and won first place. And when we left to go, no send off, there was nobody there saying congrats, you know, represent the city well, good luck, safe travel. Nobody was there. It was just like out of a movie. It was a rainy Thursday night. We out there by ourselves, just the kids and the parents. Nobody from the board, nobody from the city, nobody came to say, wish us luck, goodbye. We came back, nobody was there to greet us and say congratulations. So at that point, you started to see that it wasn't a big issue to anybody. I just think, and it's not just Weekway. music programs in the city of Newark, period, has diminished. There's not, you go into the elementary schools, we have no feeder schools. I mean, I'm literally plucking kids off the street, teaching them to play from scratch because I can't get any kids from Chancellor, which is right next door, or Carver, but anybody to play because there are no music programs in the elementary schools. So it's like it is being stripped away. And maybe this is maybe this is what needed to happen for me to get those kids as well who want to learn, but it is not presented to them and the opportunities there for them not to learn.
Well, listen, man, I am I'm excited about the work that you're doing, and we'll be giving a lot of thought to how we can help out. And then we want you to give some thought too, and say, hey, listen, Eric, you know, we think that the show has a moral responsibility, you know, to help us, and here's how you can specifically help. I saw also that some people put in the thread, I'd like to help. So I don't know if you guys have even organized it in such a way yet where you say, look, here's, you know, where we could use volunteers, and these are things that volunteers could do.
But I mean, we're getting that now. But see, one thing, what I want people to realize is this. Even though it is me, my brother, my son, and, you know, we're Weakway High School, but this is not about Weakway High School. Mm-hmm. This is the Essex and Union County Marching Band.
Right.
So if there's somebody from Union County or a music teacher here who wants to come along and help, or help with the brass, or help with the woodwinds, anybody. It's not just primarily Weakway High School. That's one of the things that I wanted to get out and what we're going to push. We got our teaching and our learning and our, we come from there, but this is not Weakway High School band. This is Essex and Union County Marching Band. And I want people to know that. So feel free to come in, you know, and help, you know, if you want to, by all means, because I know for a fact that we're going to have a lot of kids. And anybody that knows anything about marching band, when you have a great amount of horn players, you have to have a brass instructor.
Mm-hmm.
You have to have an upper brass, a lower brass. You have to have woodwinds. You understand? You have to have drums. So you have to have all that in place. And it's just me, my brother, and my son doing all of the teaching right now. So as the program grows and we get more kids, we're going to need more people to come in to teach. So, you know, I open it up to everybody that wants to come in.
Well, so here we go. So this is how I like to do it. So Fatima, love you. So she said, if 200 of us give $25 a week for a month, we'll have a $20,000. So Fatima.
Fatima Thomas.
You know Fatima?
Alumni. She went out to North Carolina A&T. One of my students, now her daughter's in the band dancing, and she comes back and helps with my horn players.
So now let me ask you this question. Because even though it is Essex Union, there would be no reason, since there is no marching band right now at Weakway, and I presume that a lot of the kids, because they know you from the neighborhood, are going to gravitate toward this right now because there is no band.
Right.
Have you had a conversation with the alumni? The Weakway High School alumni?
I spoke with Mira Lawson.
Mm-hmm.
She knows about it.
Okay.
That's all I can say.
All right. So, and this is where I put this on you now. See, the show is about provoking accountability. So I say to you, Maurice, I say to Terrence Bankston, who was running as a South Ward councilperson, right? I say to Natasha, who was in the thread and comments all the time, young folks, right? This is about you guys pitching in too and recognizing, you know, the crises.
Yeah.
And then saying, well, okay, let's see if the millennials could figure out how to have some fundraisers as well. Pitch in as well. Don't just sit on the sidelines and watch us old folks try to figure this out. Get in the game.
Of course.
Right?
Well, look, here's what I'm going to do. I'm going to talk to people I know. I'm going to make them aware of what you're doing. I'm going to try to bring them out to Weekway Park so they could get a first look. And then that opens the door.
Tell them to bring $10, $20 with them.
I'm going to try to get them to bring. Wait,
there we go. They, you understand what I'm saying? Because that's how, listen, that's how it works. That's, at the end of the day, that's how we're, look, when they have fundraisers, we even see the firefighters, right? They stand on the corners when they raise money with the firefighter buckets and their dollars.
And being funny that you mentioned that, is that when we went through the process of getting the uniforms,
mm-hmm.
the firefighters, right along with the police department, came together with the Alumni Association at that time, and they helped raise the other half of the money. Mm-hmm. You know, so they came together to also help as well, you know, the firefighters. And a big shout out to those guys. It was a combined effort when we got the uniforms and, you know, and things of that nature. But it was, I'm just saying, like, man.
Well, so this is what we're going to do, too. So, Darryl, I don't know if you know. I've been trying to put together, and at least we say on paper, we got 44 or so people who are going to walk with us for the next 10
Saturdays.
When we launch it, right? So, the Eric Dawson Radio Show, it's confirmed, guys. We're going to have a 2-year anniversary party at 78 Lounge on June 16th. We decided to do that because a lot of Muslims are celebrating Ramadan. And you know, we wanted to be respectful of that. And so we said we'd push it out so that they could come in and attend and have a good time. Hope to see you there. Yeah. There, I will tell you, my hope is that some of the folks who come, because if you come, I'm going to ask you to speak about this and get people involved who come.
Man, I'll bring the band to play. We can be a big old
hoot nanny
up there.
There we go. See, this is what I'm
talking about.
This is what I'm talking about. So we're going to have that conversation.
Okay.
Oh, my goodness. Oh, my goodness. See, this
see,
is.
See how I work on the radio and they can't even do it in the city hall?
See, but this is what it is, right? It's understanding that we have all these things going on in our community
that people aren't aware of.
That people are not aware of, and having a platform to be able to talk about it, mm-hmm. right? And then be supportive,
right.
not just lip service, mm-hmm. but be supportive, right? But we're gonna be walking in the community of at least 44 of us. I want to try to push that number up, asking critical questions of folks in the community because they're not engaged in politics. They're not engaged in anything, Darryl.
Right.
And we're going to try to find out why. Because we all live here together. You live here, so why aren't you engaged? And if we can get the answer to the great question why, then maybe we can get them engaged. But part of that, maybe what we'll do too, and we'll figure that out, is maybe we'll see if we can also give them some information about what it is you're doing.
Right.
Because with 44 people, we probably, in a 4-hour span, wind up touching 1,600 doors.
Mm-hmm. Yeah.
And if we had information about what's going on with you, maybe that could be some way to layer on and to provide support.
Yeah, that'll work. I mean, by any means necessary.
Any means.
I mean, because this is something that is definitely going to happen. And
it's happening. It's not going to happen. It's happening, bro.
It's happening. I mean, we're a lot of people are really working hard, you know, to get this off the ground. I mean, our first parade is the 4th of July parade in Montclair. So we'll be debuting our, you know, at that point, we're going to add more kids to the equation. So when you come down the street, you know, you may say, whoa.
So you're going to need. So part of what you're going to need as a nonprofit is you're going to need a fundraising apparatus,
right?
Because you're going to need year-round fundraising.
Yes.
Right. So listen, guys. Anybody who's in this thread, who has experience fundraising, right, who can pitch in, please reach out to Darryl as well because he's going to need that component. It's not just about, you know, I see an immediate need right now. We're going to run to the corners and try to get $5 to take care of that. There will be operating expenses. There'll be all kinds of things that he'll have to be able to maintain. And to be able to have a marketing and communications apparatus that goes through Union County and Essex County that continuously informs people about this program.
Right.
so that they can make contributions. And then not just the small contributions, but also reaching out to businesses, mm-hmm. small businesses, as well as corporate businesses to become sponsors and partners in this thing will be critical. So all hands are on deck.
Yeah, and that's one of the reasons why I wanted to reach out, you know, to the Essex County Exec, Union County Exec, mayors of, you know, particular, you know, of the cities,
yeah,
to see, excuse me, to see, you know, if they can get some input. The more people you have given, the less that you have to, you know, it's not like we're asking everybody to, you know, fork over all of it. If everybody comes together, mm-hmm. the burden is light on everybody. You understand?
Definitely.
And that's my goal, because this can expand. You never know. It's Essex and Union now. Mm-hmm. It may be Morris and yeah. some other county, Camden mm-hmm. County later, mixed with, you know, it can grow to be a big thing.
Oh, yeah, definitely.
You know what I'm saying? Then not only that, we can do band competitions, band festivals. And not only that, my main thing is to get the kids to the HBCU homecomings.
Yes, definitely.
One thing with Newark Public Schools is that when you take an out-of-state trip, you have to put in like a month, I think, to 3 months in advance. But I used to always say, how do we know when the college is having their homecoming and they don't know? So they pretty much plan in September when they come back. Mm-hmm. So, but most college homecomings are in October.
Yeah.
So how can we give you 3 months notice on a date that we don't know till September?
Right.
So years ago, like 2004, 5, 6, 7, we used to do HBCU homecomings all the time. We used to do Morgan, Dell State, Howard. We used to do those homecomings every year. Then all of a sudden,
stop.
You can't do it. Mm-hmm. So that took the exposure away from my kids, seeing mm-hmm. that, you know, the big band, the big sound, you know what I'm saying? Mm-hmm. So if they see this, they can say, man, I want to do that.
Yeah.
You know what I'm saying?
And it's shown where they could go. You see some bands go to the inauguration and play in the inaugural parade.
Right.
WWE, they had Florida A&M. They had Don't Play. They did one of the wrestlers' entrance things. Like it can just
go. There's no limit. You know,
it really isn't.
Also, too, what we're going to do is that we're going to have separate bands in this program. We have a lot of what I call old farts. That are some people who were in the band when I was in there, or 10, 15 years ago, they claim they still got it. So we're going to have an adult band as well. So we're going to have that band 25 and over.
Yeah.
Then we're going to come together and get together, you know, the senior band, because when we do parades in Wildwood, and other parades, you see those type of bands. You see them. I'm like, you know, that joker look 50. He said, I'm 52. You know, but it's a whole band full of gray-haired folk. You got the ladies up front dancing and twirling. You got the guys in the back playing with the drummers. I mean, they ain't doing that much, but it's fun.
Exactly.
And I know that there's a lot of alumni from not only Weekway, from Shabazz, from Central,
West Side,
that would love the opportunity to be a part of an adult band.
Mm-hmm.
You know, so we can go out and do praise. See, my goal is to have the regular band and my adult band in the same parade.
Uh-oh. Let's take this call. Hello, caller, go.
Hey, what's up, guys? Darren Martin here. How's it?
What's happening, Darren?
Hey, Darren, what's going on?
Hey, man, great conversation, great topic as usual. I applaud the brother for what he's doing. He's doing oh my gosh, I mean, that is just an unbelievable job he's doing there. I want to be able to help out any way I can. I'm in Union County, so brother, if you, I'd like, Eric, you can share my phone number with him. He can give me a call later. He needs help. I'm speaking to the mayor or whoever in Union County, or to the schools in Union County.
Nice.
I'm there, brother.
Hey, I appreciate that. That's definitely needed. I mean, if you can get me the names and numbers on the inside track there, I would love it, because my son goes to Union High School, mm-hmm. and I'm going there actually.
Well, my daughter's in Union High School.
Oh.
So don't worry about it. I'm going to set the meeting. Me and you need to talk it out. Set the meeting up.
Oh, hey, listen, that's great. Oh, man, that's great. I appreciate that.
Beautiful, man.
Great job, man. My brother, looking forward to working with our brother. Share my phone number with him, and me and you will talk later, brother, and we'll get this ball rolling.
Okay, absolutely. Thank you. I appreciate it.
Thank you, Darren. See, hey man.
And I'm a
teamwork is gonna make this dream work.
Yes. I'm gonna reach out to Assemblyman Jamel Holley. He's a friend of mine, so I'm gonna reach out to him and see if he could come to Weekway Park. Definitely.
Right. So you know, we need to continue to push, guys. And what you can do is share this episode. That's another way to get this information out, right?
Right.
Just you know, take your thumb or your index finger, whatever finger you use to push on a thing, right? And hit the share button, right? And invite some of your friends to understand exactly what's going on.
So with you know all the kids that you've dealt with and are dealing with, like what is your process of getting that open dialogue or that trust, you know, well, that keeps them coming back?
It's real simple. Is that the problem, we got to understand something when it comes to today's kids and today's youth. They're not dumb. And they can look through your BS real easy. Mm-hmm. The main thing is that they have to trust you.
Exactly.
And that they have to know that when you're telling them something, that you're not just telling them because you feel like talking. You telling them because you care. Mm-hmm. You understand? You don't know how many times I sit in the front of the school and we just talk. Band practice would be over 6:37. I can sit out there to 9:30 and 60-70% of the kids just sitting there talking. They want that love. Mm-hmm. Either we gonna give them the love, respect, attention, and protection, or the streets will.
Yeah. Mm-hmm.
And that's what it is. And what is a game? A family. Mm-hmm. You part of the game because you know for a fact that something goes down, they got your back.
Yeah.
They love you, they protect you. You got somebody to support you. Mm-hmm. You understand? If we give them that, if they can see that in the adults, then they'll gravitate towards us. But it's primarily trust. They have to believe that what you're telling them, it's truthful. Mm-hmm. And they have to believe that what you're telling them is from the heart.
Definitely.
You understand? Don't only talk to me when I'm doing wrong. Talk to me when I'm doing right as well. When I'm not doing anything, talk to me.
Yeah.
When I was a police officer, 99% of the time, we interacted with the community when there was something wrong. Mm-hmm. So it's the same thing. If the only time you speak to me and interact with me when there's something wrong, you see what I'm saying?
Yeah.
There's no trust.
Mm-hmm.
So even when I was working as a police officer, I would get out my patrol car, I see a bunch of kids playing. I get out throwing football.
Yeah.
You understand? If we was playing volleyball, get out, spike on a couple of jokers. You know, even with football, stiff arm, I knock one kid right into the car. You know, he got up, was like, oh, you got that. You know, and then later on, those same kids saw me march the band down the street. They said, ain't you that cop? I said, yeah. They said, you want to join the band? Yeah. Next thing you know, he's in practice. Mm-hmm. You know, but that is what is missing, is that we stop engaging our youth.
Yeah.
You understand? We stop talking to them. You know, we got to stop talking down to them and make them realize that, hey, listen, even though you're younger, I'm going to respect your opinions on things, too, because they have a voice.
Mm-hmm.
But a lot of them don't think that they do. Mm-hmm. That's why a lot of them don't vote. You got 18, 25 years old, they're going to say, oh, no matter who get it, they ain't going to do nothing for me. Mm-hmm. And that's what I heard this past election. I said, if you're saying that they're not going to do something for you, well, why don't you vote for somebody who you think can or at least try to make a difference? Mm-hmm. They don't want to do it because nobody is telling them that you are important. Your vote matters. What you do in the community, you do have a say. You do have a stake. They feel unimportant.
Mm-hmm.
And this is something that starts at 10, 11 years old.
Oh, yeah, definitely.
We have to realize, and people don't want to admit it, we have a problem in our community. You understand? People are not raising their kids. But for whatever reason, our kids are running amok. Mm-hmm. There's an abandoned house on my block. Every day after school, kids go up in the abandoned house and get high. I tell them every day, why y'all doing that? Y'all ain't got to do that, but what else are we going to do?
Hmm.
What can I tell them? What else you going to do? Well, I had three kids. Every day I see them go over to the house, smoke, get high. Before I left, they was about to join the band.
This went down. We ain't no band, and we ain't got nothing to do. So now they up in the house getting high. First thing they say, well, what we gonna do? Nobody shuts my mouth up. That right there, goop. What can I say?
Yeah, what can you say?
Let's take this call. Hello, caller, go.
Yeah, good morning. Once again, he had such a point. I remember being a super orange drafted face, man. I used to take kids drugs before they go to school. Used to actually take the drugs from them. I mean, I had the kind of, they had that kind of respect for me. But I used to take their drugs. I'm talking about anything from pills, marijuana, even heroin one time. I just take their drugs. I see them get high, come through the block. I used to take it from them. You have to have the nerve to show concern, and I always had that nerve, so I always had a good relationship with kids, so I always try to tell them positive things, and I even started a program at Montclair State because of that, and I'm in maintenance. I wasn't no professor, I wasn't no educator, none of that. I was a maintenance guy that started a program for students, so, I mean, you're always right, Eric. You have to get involved. You really have to talk with these kids, because I didn't have that. You understand? I try to do the opposite of what I didn't have, so it worked for me, man. I respect everything that y'all doing, everything. You know, but you have to talk to them. You have to listen. First of all, you have to listen to what they're saying,
yes.
And you have to cut through the negativity. How you do it, I don't know, but it's plenty of children, so it's always plenty of work.
Right.
There's no need to take a break. So you never take a break. You know what I mean? So, thank you.
Thanks for the call. Well, listen, here's the thing. Right. They don't respect us because we don't invest in them.
That's true.
That's it. They don't respect us because we don't invest in them. When they look at you and they said, well, Daryl, there's no band anymore. Well, that's part of it. That's an incomplete sentence. The rest of the thought is, and nobody cared enough to make sure there was. Mm-hmm. That's the rest of it.
Yeah.
So they look at you and they go, it's not. But then they look and they hear all the lip service, right?
Mm-hmm.
Out in the community about, oh, we need this. Oh, we need that. Oh, the kids ain't got this. Oh, the kids can't have that. Oh, we got to have this for the kids. Oh, we got to. And now a lot of those kids go, well, where are these people?
Yeah.
Where were the protests when the band was falling apart?
Mm-hmm.
Where was the money and the resources when all of this was happening? So, like you said, they smell the BS.
Mm-hmm. Of course.
Right? Why? Because if you ain't putting up, then they say, shut up.
Yeah. And that's what, that goes back to what I was saying, is that they're not dumb. I see the way that they treat them. You know, and the biggest misconception in education is if you don't have a degree, you don't know what you're doing. And that right there is the biggest facade I've ever seen in my life. So you're telling me, because I don't hold a bachelor's or a master's degree in education or psychology, that I don't know what the hell I'm talking about? There's not a book written out there that can tell you how to deal with the youth today. Show me a book. There's not a book written. You want to know why? Because it can't be written. Because nobody could have foreseen what is going on now. Okay? Who knew that we would abandon our children? That our community would fall apart? That when we have leaders in position that are our color, that they totally abandon the community? You understand? I'm not saying that's happening in North, but it's happening all over the place. You understand? This is just what is going on. So they saying, well, man, we got to black this, we got to black this, we got to black this, and we still ain't got nothing. What's the use? Mm-hmm. And this is what I hear. Everybody think, oh, well, man, things are going to change. We got a black president or whatever. I loved Obama. I loved him because he was classy. But I tell people this all the time, and they argue with me. I said, black folk was in the same position the day he got in and the day he left. In my opinion, nothing changed.
I read a quote yesterday from somebody on my page who said, since the 60s to now, we've had a 900% increase in African-American leadership. 900%. And our conditions are worse. Not the same. Our conditions have worsened.
We don't even stick together. Look,
every brother ain't a brother, every sister ain't a sister. They get what they want and they sell us up the river. But at the same time, like you said, we can't condition ourselves to depend on them to bring it to us.
That's right.
We have to go get it.
We have to go get it.
And before we take this call, I was listening. I love Tupac. That's like my favorite rapper of all time. He said, you know, you can't tell me who to love because since y'all weren't the ones coming to me, educating me, bringing me resources that I needed to get to where I need to be at, he said, you can't stop me from loving the gang members, the drug dealers, the pimps. You can't stop me from loving them because they taught me and taught the rest of us how to get what we needed when it was supposed to be your job. So you can't be mad at these kids if they turn it to where they see love and affection. It may not be the love and affection that they need, but that's what they seeing. Gangs are not just saying, oh, come on, we gonna embrace you. They showing it. So if somebody getting pieced up and you see the handshakes or, you know, they see them under their wing, to them, that's love. Mm-hmm. You know what I'm saying? So if y'all want to cut that cycle, then y'all got to get involved. Stop being on the sideline and saying, oh, I can't stand this and I hate how things going. Okay, so if you hate it so much, then that's the reason to get out the vote. That's the reason to get involved. Absolutely. This is what our ancestors and our elders died and fought for. We had a right to do the stuff that we do because they put it down.
Right.
We the ones that, the people after them are the ones that dropped it. And now y'all didn't leave us in a position where we could go ahead and say, you know what, we gonna pick this ball back up. Now I'm gonna be honest, I don't have a degree, but look how far I've come.
Mm-hmm.
Working on campaigns, talking to the youth. Yes, I am back in school getting 2 bachelor's degrees, 1 in business and 1 in public administration. So that was me like, you know what, okay, I see what I can do, but I also see what I can do to go further. You know what I'm saying? So we have to go ahead and show them, just like with your music program, that music will be your way. If you want to leave North and experience the world, music will be that way. It don't just have to be football. It just don't have to be basketball.
Right.
You know, we could teach them boxing, martial arts. We could teach them music. We could teach them agriculture, teach them science. We could go different ways. We can't be subjected to just that status quo that you got to pick up a ball and make it out.
Right.
It's not true.
We're going to take this call, and I'm going to give you the last word now. Hello, caller, go.
Hey, this is Ali. Hey, Darryl.
Yes.
Darryl, this is Ali Bombin. How you doing?
Hey, what's going on, brother?
You know, I know we know each other.
Yep.
You know? So, it's an idea. When I lived in Mendham for 18 years, all the kids had to have, you know, in the fourth grade, they had to have, fourth to the seventh grade, they had to have instruments.
Right.
And then when I went to 18th Avenue 50 years ago, we did too. But what they did was they had a lease program where lease to buy or lease. So it might be an idea to lease it and everything. I got news that Weequay is going to hire another band, a leader. Don't take it offended. The state of New Jersey requires that anybody that gives instruction have to have 660
credits. No, I understand.
That's how it goes.
I understand.
That's the rule of the state of New Jersey.
Right, I understand.
It's not personal. You know, and don't worry, the mayor's not going to let you go down anyway because you was every time the governor, anybody ever came in, it was the Weequay High School band.
Right.
And of course, you know I'm alum of 1972.
Right.
And I'm going to do something to help you too, okay?
I appreciate it, brother.
Thanks for the call.
All right, but you're a hero, man. You know I love you, man.
Yeah, I know, brother. You're a good brother.
Thanks for the call.
All right, thank you, man.
Right. See, that's one of the things that I did take it personal at first. But, you know, understand, but I realized I said, this is what they want. This is the quality. I got it. And so once I got it, I said, okay. So what I told you before, I had rolled in Thomas Edison University for my life experience credits.
Mm-hmm.
You understand?
Right.
I get the money, I'll be graduating next May with a bachelor's degree in education.
Look. So what I'm going to say is this. They could do it. I've seen.
I did it. You understand?
I've seen things work out when electeds want them to work out. I've seen it. I'll leave it there, right? But one door closes, another one opens.
Yes.
Mm-hmm. And I think that person who told you that you're destined for bigger things, I don't doubt that And I think that what you're going to do in terms of expanding the love of music and opportunity and exposure to kids across Essex County and across Union County and then beyond is going to be extraordinary. Mm-hmm. And, you know, I welcome, you know, going along for the ride with you, man.
I appreciate
and helping out any way that we can. Well, brother, always, I appreciate you coming in. And you're going to come in next week?
Oh, definitely. Next week when I come in, I'll have all the information. And I'm going to have your shirt. And then I'm going to have the logo that everybody can see, you know, to see. And
I want a shirt, too.
Oh, listen, you get a shirt, too, brother. I just want to say thank you to give me an opportunity to, you know, get this out about the program. It's going to be great. It's going to be great. We're going to reach out to a lot of kids. And I'm going to bring all races together. And we're going to come down the street.
I think this program is going to bridge a gap.
Yes.
That's what I believe.
Hey, look, man. You know what? It's not going to be great. It is already great. We just have, it just has to manifest itself. Yeah. Yes. That's all.
And I think, I believe it will.
Mm-hmm.
I definitely believe it will.
Yes.
Maurice, man, always, brother, get those young people, because...
Hey, that's what, look, man, that's what we live for, man.
I'm right.
We giving them a seat at the table. If no one else will, we will.
And you guys start stacking some of your dollars so that you can be helpful, right?
Yes.
Make sure you share the episodes so that more people know. Mm-hmm. And then anybody who has a skill set that can help Daryl in this program... Please volunteer. Thanks for tuning in.
Wake up, all teachers, time to teach a new way. Maybe then they'll listen to what you have to say. They're the ones who's coming up, and the world is in their hands. When you teach the children to jump the very best.
Radio show. Now that you've received this dose of thought-provoking information, why not put it to good use? Spread the word and turn your knowledge into action.
That's always helpful. Folks become more informed, and hopefully through the discussion, we can engage them, and then through the information, they can be empowered to make a change in the community.
Tune in regularly for more food for thought. This has been the Eric Dawson Radio Show on RTH 2000.